Hello, my dear friends. My name is Inessa Levkina, and today I'd like to speak to you about musical forms. They seem to me an interesting subject, because they are not so obvious as in the visual arts, like architecture, sculpture, paintings. In those arts, one can see the whole form instantly, including all the details. And besides, first of all, we see the main form, and after that, its components. Music, on the contrary, exists in time, giving us one detail after another. And the musical forms appears in our mind gradually. In this regard, music is more like literature, like storytelling. And like a story, music piece is solid, but consists of smaller pieces divided from each other by sense. You know that in common language, even a comma put on the wrong place can change the meaning of your message, like here. There is a huge difference between inviting grandma to eat and inviting to eat grandma. Indeed, a comma can save lives. Musical commas, caesuras, come seldom with a bar line or with a new line on the page of the sheet music that you are playing. Look at this example. This is the opening theme of Ronda alla Turca by Mozart. And when I ask students to play the second part of it, they often begin with the second line and here and I hear this. Which is completely wrong, because this melody is based on iambic upbeat motives that all begin in the middle of the measure. To begin such a phrase with a bar line, like saying "had a little lamb" instead of "Mary had a little lamb." Here you can see the main forms of academic music. Knowing these forms helps us to understand the structure and logic of the music piece, discover its meaning and deep intentions of the composer. And besides, helps us to put all commas on their right places. Today, we'll begin with the smallest musical form that can formulate complete musical thought, the period. Period is mainly used for musical themes inside the larger forms and sometimes as an autonomous piece. It always ends with a full cadence, like this. This is the framework of a classical parallel symmetrical period that consists of 8 measures and is made of 2 sentences in succession. The first one, antecedent, comes to a point of partial completeness. The second, consequent, has the same length and concludes with a sense of greater completeness. These sentences can be divided in phrases. Phrases can be divided in motives, the smallest structural unit that we can recognize and remember, like ta-ta-ta-ta. Prelude in A major by Frédéric Chopin is a perfect example of such a form. It is characterized by balance and symmetry. Throughout the whole piece, we can hear the same rhythm, typical for a dance, with one curious detail. It stops at the end of every phrase, together with the melody, making it sound more poetical, like an idea of a dance, a dream of a dance, not the dance itself.
Thank you.
This period consists of two sentences, each of them 8 measures long. I've marked a borderline between them with a big black V. Each of them is divided into 2 phrases, 4 measures long. The two sentences look alike, but the second one is variated. It begins with a little bit more intensity, preparing the culmination in the 12th measure, which I marked with a big black star. And this is exactly the third quarter of the whole piece, so-called the point of golden ratio. Here the melody reaches the highest tone. In harmony, we hear the first and only modulating chord, which resolves in subdominant, one and only, which makes the final cadence stronger in comparison to the one in the first sentence. So this prelude is a classic example of a parallel symmetrical period, only bigger. But every musical form is unique, and there are a lot of different types of period. For instance, these two. In Norwegian dance, we can find a period with 3 sentences. Another interesting example is this hybrid theme from Sonata Opus 10 by Beethoven. It mixes the features of the sentence and a period. This one we can't divide in parts, but it definitely passes for a complete musical thought. Another common musical form is binary. It consists of 2 sections, each of which has its own full cadence. And at the first sight, it seems very simple to compose such a form. You just take one period and put another one next to it, and voila! But if you try to do so, you will realize that your piece would remind you very much of a bourrime. You know this game when you have to write the next sentence in the poem knowing only the last word of the previous one. As a result, you often get silly poems which do rhyme but make little sense. Sections of the music piece must have something in common in order to make a solid form. That's why the early Baroque pieces of the 17th, 18th century were often based on the same material as this minuet trio. Later, composers began to use the new material in the second section. It brought more contrast and made the pieces more interesting. In the first section of Organ Grinder from his youth album, Tchaikovsky uses a real song that he heard in Venus. The second theme he composes himself. Thank you. At the first sight, everything changes in the B section. Transparent melody accompaniment from the beginning gives place to a more saturated texture. On rhythmic level, short iambic active motives come in place of calm choreic ones of the first melody. Melodical structure is also changed. First we have long, wide breathing phrases, then short, excited motives. But if we look closely, we'll discover the same intonations in both melodies. They even appear in the same context. I've marked them with the brackets of different colors, pink, yellow, and purple slur. This one is literally repeated. Look, this is the intonation at the end of the first section. And this one appears at the end of the whole piece. Also, the pedal tone, imitating an old organ, is in the second section, is previewed in the first two measures. These melodies are closely related. From the beginning of the 19th century, rounded binary form is used more and more often. It still has two sections, A and B, but part of the A section comes back at the end of the piece. And as a result, it seems to be more coherent, the whole piece. And we just love to hear something familiar, something we can recognize. It is psychologically determined. Have you mentioned a song that you didn't like in the first place become one of your favorites after 1 week listening on the radio? I have. In fact, it happens all the time. This is how the hit songs are made. Actually, these hits are not airplayed that often because we love them. On the contrary, we love them because we've heard them so many times on the radio. Old French Song by Peter Tchaikovsky is a rounded binary form with a variated reprise. The final cadence includes a new chord, second quintsext chord, that can be marked as the most beloved chord by Tchaikovsky. Listen and remember. It gives a new color on the harmonical level and makes the final cadence stronger. If at least one of the sections in binary form is more than a period, we call it a complex binary form. In Neapolitan Song from the same youth album by Tchaikovsky, we definitely hear three periods. First two of them have different melodies, but accompaniment and texture remain the same. Also, the recognizable rhythm from the beginning, ta-ga-da-ga-da-ga-da-ta, comes back in second period. Listen. In the third period, everything changes: tempo, rhythm. Even the vocal nature of the first two periods become instrumental. Just try to sing along. So we do have three periods here, but only two musical ideas. The one of a beautiful song and another of a temperamental dance. Therefore, it is binary, even though the second section is twice as short. Ternary form has three definite sections. A. Exposition of the musical idea. B. New contrasting idea or developing of the first one. And again, A. Comeback of the first idea and its confirmation. In The Wild Horseman, Schumann creates an image of energetic movement using the active iambic motifs throughout the whole piece, built on the arpeggio patterns, which we associate with the sounds of a hunting horn. The first section is composed in A minor. It is a parallel symmetrical period consisting of two sentences. Antecedent ends with the open cadence on dominant, like this. And consequent ends with a full cadence on tonica, like this. Section B is developmental. Contrast is made through putting the first melody in bass and in a major key, F major. Reprise is not variated. Section A is repeated without any changes, as you could hear. Ternary form historically grew from rounded binary form through more and more development in the middle section and reprise. Sometimes it's even difficult to say whether it's binary or ternary. We have to consider a lot of facts to decide. Look at another piece from the youth album by Schumann, The First Sorrow. The B section here is also developmental, as in The Wild Horseman. And we hear contrast in texture, clear melody and accompaniment at the beginning and at the end of the piece, contrasts the polyphony in the middle. Also, harmonic and clarity of the A section changes in non-stop modulating in B. At first sight, we hear something ternary, but the size of the segments make it more like binary, because both segments are 16 measures long. Besides, there is no cadence between the middle segment and reprise, what makes the whole B section more solid. If at least one of the sections of the ternary form is more than a period, we call it a complex ternary form. Very often, both sections are structurally even, But B-section can also be less developed, being a period or even some modulating developing episode. Reprise can be shorter or longer than the first section. It can be variated on different levels or just repeated. Sometimes recapitulation is even not written. Composer just puts a remark da capo, as in the following example. This is Mazurka in A minor by Frédéric Chopin. Actually, Chopin didn't only compose it, he also invented the whole genre of mazurka. Chopin used features of three Polish dances, mazur, oberek, and kujawiec, that were dear to him, being homesick in Paris, having no possibility to return to his fatherland. What's really typical for mazurka? First of all, a triple meter, but also dotted rhythm at the first beat, turning rounded motifs in the melody. This mazurka is a complex ternary form da capo. A section is a rounded binary. The main key is A minor and sounds very melancholic. Just listen to it. B section is a ternary C, B, C. It moves to a major key, which provides a bright contrast to the beginning section. It sketches a cheerful village feast. Even when in the middle section, D, it moves to F sharp minor, the whole character doesn't change a lot due to the wild leaps in the melody. Da capo brings us back to melancholic mood of the A section. Theme and variations consist of a theme and unregulated number of variated repeatings. The early examples of such a form appeared in the early 17th century and they are called basso ostinato variation. In these pieces, the bass line remains unchanged. And they are based on the fashionable dances of the second half of 16th century, Chacona and Passacaglia. And it strikes me always, how did they both manage to change so dramatically in some 70, 80 years from festive carnival dances to slow, tragic, mournful musical genres that we know from the works of Bach, Handel, and Buxtehude. As a matter of fact, two Spanish writers, Cervantes and Lope de Vega, both wrote that Chacona, for example, had wild character of a lovely seductive dance song from the New World, accompanied by guitars, castagnettes, tamburans, and supported by texts like Vida, Vida, Vida Bona, Vida Vamos a Chacona, which means life is good, go Chacona. Anyway, This is how Bach uses this chacona in his Crucifixus choir in Hohe Mess in Ha moll. This piece consists of a theme and 12 variations. Each of them has the same ground bass line, repeated again and again, that gives us a feeling of inevitable fate. It gives foundation to variated chords and free development in choral voices. The theme and all variations end up on dominant, which resolves in tonica at the beginning of the next variation. This makes basso ostinato form very solid. Basso ostinato were very popular in the 17th century. From the beginning of the 18th century, they gave place to classical figurative variations. In such a variation cycle, tonality and form of the theme are not changed. Melody and texture get all the composer's attention. Besides, one variation is often written in the opposite key, and also tempo and time signature are often changed in two final variations. Popular songs and melodies of that time were used as themes for such variation cycles. This one Mozart knew as A vous dirige maman. It is still popular and we know it as Twinkle Twinkle Little Star. It is a calm, balanced melody, where the opening fifth leap is directly filled in with the descending seconds. Rhythm is also calm and steady. Only in cadence zones we hear dotted rhythm that brings some energy, even drama, gives a resolute ending to every sentence, while melisma before this rhythm brings some playful elements to the theme. Theme is given as a duet in a rounded binary form, followed by 12 variations. In each of them, Mozart explores different features that are latently present in the theme. For instance, scale-based steps from the theme become virtuosic passages in the first variation. A playful element develops in the variation 5. Voices singing the theme together get more polyphonic development in the variation 8. We can actually hear two people talking and maybe even arguing. Dramatic dotted rhythm from the theme is put under a magnifying glass in the variation 11, Adagio. After Mozart, variation cycle became more and more free of regulations. So in modern music, it's sometimes almost impossible to recognize a theme after modifications. Another musical form that grew from a popular dance is rondo. French circle dances rondo consisted of numerous verses, all of them with the same refrain. In classical rondo, all refrains are given in the main key and episodes note. Second episode is usually more contrasting to refrain than the first one. Everybody recognizes this refrain. This refrain is a rounded binary form in A minor. It is built on a characteristic complementary rhythm that gives it improvisational features, something common with the preludes by Bach, for instance. First episode B explores major key, beginning in F major, modulating to C major. It gives us a sunny, joyful image. Episode C is completely different. It sounds dramatic because of lots of diminished seventh chords, like this. Repeated bass notes, like this. And bright contrasts between piano and forte. Just listen. Refrains are repeated without changes, which is usual for a classical rondo. The final refrain gives us a nice feeling as if we've met a good old friend again. The most complex and dynamic musical form is sonata. It is based on a dialectic contrast and unity of two themes that become actually two characters. that interact, struggle, and finally find a new balance. This contrast may be more or less intensive. Some early sonatas even were composed on one theme, but what remains constant is the tonal plan of sonata. Primary and subordinate themes appear in exposition in different keys. Usually it is dominant subordinate key for a major main tonality or relative subordinate key in a minor key sonata. After more or less intensive development, both themes appear in recapitulation in the main key, which gives them a new balance, especially if major key or subordinate theme becomes minor. In this piano sonata by Beethoven, primary theme is given in G minor. It has a melancholic character and vocal nature. Subordinate theme establishes a B flat major key and brings a new playful bouncing sound. This sound is rather different in recapitulation when this theme appears in G minor. If the major mode of the subordinate theme is not changed, still there remains the crucial dialectical contrast between the themes that reaches a new quality in recapitulation as a result of development. This is why a sonata is so widely used in academic music since 18th century till now. So this is what I'd like to share with you today. I have to admit that our today's topic is rather voluminous, so in one academic hour we could only cover it quite superficially. I didn't even mention such forms as arch or strophic or through composed. That's why I'm planning to prepare more detailed lectures about every musical form in the future. Thank you for your attention.